to the March 15th meeting of the Community Preservation Committee. As always, we begin with general public comment, not having to do with the three specific proposals. But anyone like to comment on anything generally? No? Okay, moving on to approval of the minutes. And I can't remember, what is the date?
Those are November 30th.
November 30th.
And at Chris's request, I made one addition, oh, and there's a one typo. And one addition to clarify that we also discussed previous spending for the conservation fund. And then hard cost spending had never gone above $20,000.
Great, thank you for that, Chris. Is there a motion to approve?
I just want to comment. I think that was the meeting I'm not there, so it's my name from the present.
I didn't list who was there, so that.
Is there a motion at the top?
No, I didn't in my notes.
The last one was November 30th. Is there a motion to approve? A second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? All opposed? Moving right along. Chair's report. I think I will speak on behalf of the committee, offering my sympathy to Sarah and your family for the loss of her father. So that's a hard time. A lot of us are at that age. Our parents are going. So our condolences to you and your family, Sarah. And without further ado, we have three applicants for this round of funding. The Conservation Commission Conservation Fund, the Northampton Fair Housing Assessment, and the Hampshire Expansion Project. I think we'll just go through the way they are listed here, if that's okay. And we'll begin with the Conservation Commission Conservation Fund.
Thank you. So as you know, we currently have the Conservation Fund, which you all funded in the last round. That fund is all encumbered, so we've either spent it or we've signed for projects or just waiting for title searches and those things going forward. So that was sort of finished. And if you remember, when it came before you last time, I said, you know, we're asking for a lot of money. We hadn't had a conservation fund for 2 or 3 years, so we had a lot of projects that were moving through, and we're at the point where we could no longer sign for new projects. So we're trying to go forward. We are always careful at signing options to buy. So you've heard me say this before, but it's important. Most agencies, when they buy land, get options on the land and they pay for the option because the seller of the property is taking some risk. We, in the 31 years I've been here, buying about 20% of the city, we've never not exercised an option. And that's been wonderful because we can tell sellers that, and we say, no guarantee it's not going to happen at some point, but we don't pay for options, unlike most other people. We have backed away on just one deal. If the site was contaminated, part of our due diligence is looking hard, but we've never backed away for lack of funding. So when I didn't have any money, I was really cautious to sign options. On the other hand, deals take a long time, so we signed a little bit ahead of having money, so it's sort of less risk. So right now, we have two properties adding up to $125,000. Signed under option. That is, if we can get funding, we can move forward in those. And we have about five properties adding up to about $50,000 that we haven't signed. They're not ready to do that yet, but we have very interested sellers, and I think we could do that if we went forward. And so we're asking for $40,000 to help. Now, not that that would necessarily get us the entire 175, but we'd be able to do a lot of it. You know, we tend to be able to match the funds that you give us for conservation funds by 2 or 3 or 4 to 1, and so that would be my plan going forward. The matches would be from a combination of other grants, from community fundraising, and then we've been getting for a number of years now money from the mayor's office and city council that pays for land that's in back taxes. So if I'm buying a piece of land that's worth, say, $10,000, and they owe $6,000 in back taxes, $6,000 is owed to the city pays for it. They pay it, it goes back to the city. So your fund sort of matched those things, grants, you know, community fundraising. That is a secret. So I think they're all exciting projects. They vary from one area. You know, we've been trying to do more sort of heritage sites. So there's a man who does tours of lead mines off Loudville Road, and he helped us find a spot right off of Route 66, which is right next to some other conservation land that we own. James Thompson, our GIS guy, then looked at what's called LIDAR, which is laser imagery, and he found that this lead guy knew of like two lead mines, and he found like four more. So one of the parcels is full of lead mines. So it's everything from that sort of heritage site to just traditional open space and trails. So it's those three categories. That's what I have, unless there's questions.
Questions for Wayne? Wayne, I have one question. When I was looking at the sort of addendum to the proposal, and in the very old fingers to work, at the very end, there's a listing of totals through October 2014, and I don't understand where it says 3,357 acres, and I'm not quite understanding where that number is coming from. So I added up the acres, and I'm not getting anything close to that. So I'm wondering.
I don't know the answer. Okay. Rather than making up something now, can I look it up and send an email you guys?
Sure.
Or that would be,
yeah, that would be helpful. I'm wondering if it's a misprint.
Yeah.
Because again, I went back and totaled acres up and didn't get anything.
Did you get, is it possible I missed a decimal point?
It could be, yeah.
Okay, let me just check rather than trying to figure it out.
Okay.
Yes, it's definitely not that big because that's about what we own
right.
In total. So.
So I'm thinking maybe it's a tenth.
We have a very different question, and I should know the answer to this, but I don't. Is there a social history to these lead mines?
Is there what?
Is there a social history of these lead mines?
Yeah, they were. So this I only know from this expert. I don't claim to have done any research. This guy gives the tour. But the first ones, you know, hand dug, he says date back to the late 18th century.
Were these miners or these farmers who did this?
It's a good question. From my understanding, they were very small miners. They weren't like big commercial operations. People would do their own mines. The mines that you see there now were definitely more developed. So the earliest piece goes back, and I say, a long, long time. The ones that are more obvious were clearly done as commercial operations. They dug down, and then they dug a side channel. And the side channel apparently was to drain it. We sort of assumed that was actually how they brought the lead out, but apparently they still did it from the top for doing it. So what you see was definitely a fairly sophisticated operation, but he said there were older ones before them. This is, you know, we think of this as the lead area, but this is all part of the Mineral Hills. And so Mineral Hills obviously renamed because of the minerals.
Is the spill or whatever they call all the extra ore, is that dangerous?
It may be. That's one of the due diligence we have to do. So that's it's called galena. I'm sure I'm mispronouncing it. So lead comes in different minerals, and some minerals are more stable than others. And so galena is supposed to be one of the more stable, but clearly the overburden, they tried to get as much lead as they could, but the overburden is the term. Mm-hmm. So we tend to use Kevin O'Reilly at OTO as a licensed site professional. We're going to look at it. And he said it would really be based on a determination from DEP, which we haven't done yet. Okay, it's basically, what do they consider background conditions? So just as an example, when we sold the old fire station, we did due diligence there. We found elevated levels of radioactivity. And we turned out that was from the native soil, was granitic soil, granitic in origin, to granite. And that has high concentrations of radioactive materials. And therefore, we're not responsible for cleaning up natural things. But clearly, if somebody dumped things, we would have been. So the question for DEP is, if it's some 300 years ago or 200 years ago, at what point, if ever, does it become a background condition?
Was there never a community of miners?
I don't know enough about that. So
we're in ethnicity, yeah.
Yeah, I don't think we could. If you're interested, we could get this guy's passionate about it. So everybody knows what he's told me. He loves talking to people, giving tours.
And where is this that he does this?
This is off Route 66. If you go west of 66 past Glendale Road, there's sort of a sharp curve to the, and it starts going up a hill, and there's a sharp curve to the left. Almost immediately where the road turns, you're up the hill maybe a third of the way. Almost immediately it turns to the left. If you cut off to the right, you go back there and find this person. You all proved last year, just a round ago, us buying some land from Fred Fierst. So not, it wasn't a separate thing. It was that when you gave me authority to $20,000 in the last conservation fund, that's the land that's just west of this property.
Wayne, am I correct in that the project summary reads the same for all the other times you've asked for money for this fund, except for the fact that hard costs are now at 10,000 rather than 20,000?
That's correct. Because our understanding that was your preference.
Yes.
Obviously, the bigger, more flexibility.
So thank you for changing that. But other than that, it's the same thing.
That's correct.
And the balance now is at about zero, is that right?
Well, there's money, but all of it's encumbered. So there's things we've signed contracts for, we've told our attorneys to go ahead and close.
So the unencumbered is at zero.
Is right. At zero. There's, you know, from when I tell the attorneys to go ahead and buy the land, there's often a 2 month lag. So there may still be money for another 2 months as those projects go through.
Any other questions for Wayne? As always, thank you, Wayne.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Wayne.
Okay, so the next project we would like to hear from is the Northampton Fair Housing Assessment.
Yes. Hello. My name is Jim Reese. I'm a member of the Housing Partnership. Hank Keller is sick tonight, who was going to come, the Housing and Community Development Senior Planner, but unfortunately couldn't make it. Would you like me to highlight some of the proposal? I know we submitted, there were some questions which Peg responded to.
Yeah, highlighting.
Highlighting is good?
Okay. Good. We've all hopefully read the proposal.
Okay. So the partnership serves as the city's Fair Housing Committee. And in order to receive federal funding, the CDBG money, the HUD has put out that cities have to respond to this requirement to update their fair housing assessment. The city last completed an assessment in 2012. It's a very detailed 30-page tool, which many times when HUD puts stuff out, it's like, oh, this doesn't make any sense. Peg Keller, who's more knowledgeable and has to respond to a lot of the reporting requirements and has seen this more than I have over the years, really thinks this is a good tool. So even if there's some question, because I guess there is, about whether Dr. Carson is going to follow through on what they've already put out, Peg thinks that's a good thing for Northampton and for the Housing Partnership in the city and other departments to actually continue to go ahead and do this assessment. So hopefully they will, well, whether they continue or not, we think it's a worthwhile assessment to update this sort of thing to make sure that the protected classes in Northampton are in fact protected, and our goals for the partnership and for the city are really the correct ones. Let me see if there's anything else I want to highlight. We're asking for $20,000 for 1 year to hire a qualified assessment to really do this job, particularly given that Peg has many other responsibilities and the partnership and other city employees really don't have the capacity to do the extensiveness that this tool require. We really think that we need a consultant to do this.
Thank you, Shannon. Questions?
If this is totally unfair to ask you, Jim, as a pinch hitter.
Go ahead.
And I'm thinking
but you're a friend. It's okay.
But I'm thinking you probably don't know the answer to this. But I'm just wondering how other communities pay for this? Do you have any?
I don't. But it certainly, I could ask Peg and have that.
And I know.
She would probably be more knowledgeable about that.
I mean, the history indicates that CPA funds have been used, they've been used before to pay for this.
Mm-hmm.
Just not all communities have it, I just wondered.
Yep, it's a good question. No. I will get in touch with her and we can get you that information.
So you've got a 5-year span on this from when the last one was done, is that?
I'm sorry, go ahead.
It was done in 2012, is that what you said?
Yes.
So it's 5 years, a sort of standard interim?
I don't know if it's a standard interim. In my experience, HUD is unpredictable, so whenever they decide, so I'm not sure it's an every 5-year thing.
Was there a consultant hired when it was done in 2012?
Unfortunately, I was in a partnership. That's where, unfortunately, paid me here. But I could certainly, again, another good question.
We did not pay for this then.
We funded a different study. This may have been part of it, but I believe it was separate.
In 2012?
Yes.
So you were, so you got an answer to that question, or should I ask Peg?
Still looking.
Okay, yeah, so I'll have Peg get back to you on that. Yep.
That would be.
Yep.
Other questions for Jim? Jim, I have one question. Where did the $20,000 figure come from?
Again, unfortunately, with Peg not being here and other members of the committee, remember having previous consultants, and it's a ballpark number. It's a ballpark number. I again could ask Peg for more detail. I think there's some relationship to what previously has been needed for other consultations, but I can again ask that of Peg.
We funded a strategic plan.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
We did not fund this particular plan.
And was that, was there a dollar amount there?
What's a strategic plan?
This was a very detailed, unfortunately I didn't bring it, 80-90 page strategic plan that did some of what HUD is now asking for, which really looked at the city, looked at data, came up with some very detailed plans and recommendations, went right through all this sort of variable or for affordable housing plans that other cities have found successful and made some specific recommendations. So it was a very detailed plan that the city received. And actually,
is it like have a number of years going forward, or just
right? Made lots of specific recommendations about specific goals, about they analyzed at that point the data, very detailed.
What?
Should have brought it. I just looked at it at home.
When was that?
2012.
Oh, that was
2012. Or what? Sarah, is that right?
It was completed in 2012.
Yep.
They awarded funding in 2008.
Yep.
And it was $35,000. Oh, they didn't get it. There's a delay in funding here for 3 years.
Other questions?
Can you? You referred to the previous plan and what you hope to do with this one is this is a useful tool that's utilized a lot?
This is a brand new tool. It was attached to the application. It's 30 pages long. And we felt that, you know, it involves holding public hearings. It involves more detailed census analysis. It requires supposedly HUD was going to provide additional information for communities to complete this beyond what's available now. And just we felt that in terms of the detail of analyzing all the protected classes and exactly where Northampton is at and what we could and should focus on, particularly in the priority order. So again, it's I think it was attached, I don't know if you got the full proposal, it's pretty long, 30 pages, yeah.
Yeah.
But it looked good to us, which sometimes HUD stuff doesn't look so good, but this particularly looked like a good to use.
The current, or the recent HUD rule said that you had to submit one of these.
Right.
But the one in 2012 was just done for local consumption?
It wasn't, in fact, let me just, because I think Peg did a good job, and the 2012 one wasn't as detailed, didn't really require the detailed planning and recommendations that this one does. So it was, and it wasn't even necessary that cities received it. Supposedly, if you got audited, you could be found out of compliance, but it wasn't something that even needed to be submitted. This supposedly needs to be submitted, and it's just much more detailed.
So they were both mandated? They were both mandated,
yes,
theoretically?
They were. Yeah, this one, yeah.
And you indicated that one was strategic, which implies that you were going to be using from it. It wasn't just broad-based.
Yes.
Have you used?
Yes, we have used it.
And you have completed much or some of what you wanted or gone along the way with it? I mean, you've been using it from that point of view?
We feel we've made a lot of progress. It's a difficult thing in this community, which for many people is not affordable. And but in terms of trying to maximize what could be done in terms of trying to support those proposals that really, you know, like the latest ones on Pleasant Street and other recommendations that we've made in holding fair housing workshops for tenants and landlords, making recommendations. There's now CDBG money that is funding support for people that are going to housing court for evictions. There's so in terms of trying to focus on, in fact, what the plan highlighted for us in terms of what the really needs are, we certainly have tried to do that. Yeah.
This may be an unfair question, or maybe just a statement, is it always sort of makes me anxious to fund a consultant for $20,000 to tell us that we need more low-income housing when we all know that, rather than putting that $20,000 right into low-income housing, like the Hampshire Expansion Project, which comes up next.
Mm-hmm.
But this is a requirement by HUD. But is the consultant a requirement? I mean, hiring a consultant is not a requirement?
No.
No. So if we didn't fund this, what would happen?
What Peg Keller tells me is she couldn't do this. I don't know if you've looked at the 30-page thing, but in terms of holding the number of public hearings, in terms of doing the analysis, it's really beyond the capacity of the city of Northampton to really complete. So, if in fact HUD follows through and says, you know, you have to do, because they're very specific in terms of you have to address this, it couldn't be really, in our opinion, adequately completed.
Any questions?
I wonder if maybe this is a follow-up thing as well. There's language about how this new tool is different from the tool that you enclosed that was done previously, and I guess I was a little unclear on what the differences are. It sounds like we all might be a little unclear.
Yeah, and unfortunately, I, again, wasn't around for the 2012. I could certainly
have paid. Well, I mean, it's right here, though. I guess the question is more, what's the new one?
The new one was attached.
New one?
Yeah.
No, the 20.
I can. 20.
This is the 20. Oh, there are two in.
Sarah may not have attached it to our
Maybe
comments.
She didn't attach it.
There was one incredibly long document that I have online in the application.
Oh,
I didn't copy.
You're welcome to keep that and pass it around.
Thanks.
And does this have to be provided theoretically before the next time you go to HUD for money?
It needs to be completed by next year.
by the end of 2018? Is that what you mean?
It needs to be completed, or what? Like, what happens if it's not? I'm not just
theoretical. What they are saying is that in order to continue to receive CDBG money, you have to complete this and submit this to HUD.
So stuff that's already been cyclically coming.
Yes, we've been getting, right. I'm not sure exactly how much money the city of Northampton gets. And it's for housing and other projects, but it's a substantial amount of money. There's some question about whether the Republicans are going to try to tax it, but it's money that we have been receiving and depending upon, not just for housing.
It's not just new applications, though. It's not just new applications, it's existing.
Existing, right. We've gotten it year after year after year, right? We're an entitlement community for that money.
Okay.
Any questions?
Yeah. So this is a tool that would be very useful to you to use. Once it's complete, is it widely distributed? Is it useful to other people besides? And how widely does that get information get distributed once it's
certainly produced? It's not just for the partnership, but certainly the city, any boards in the city that are related to this housing, it's going to be a publicly available information. There's going to be public hearings that will be a part of the process to complete it. So certainly it would be something that we would highlight in editorials and releasing the information on my, I assume they would post it on the Northampton website, that sort of thing.
Okay,
that you're asking.
Every purchase service, contract service that the city engages in involves bidding and a request for proposals.
Exactly.
And then a more or less a revelation of what that bidding process was, so that it's open and transparent. Is this the result? Is this $20,000 a result of that commercial bidding process?
It would be put out for a bid. It would be put out to multiple prospective consultants, and records would be kept about the submissions and how
so
much
this
money.
This is the result of that. The 20,000 request is the result of that process?
If we receive the money.
Oh, okay. So
there's a time frame in here. I think it's on the last page where we would put this out, request for proposals. In July, we'd receive them by September 1st. There would be a determination about who was the selected. Is that what you're asking?
The city can't go out to bid until the funds are actually in hand. So that July date, I believe, is Peg's estimate of when the documents would be able to put together as soon as the funding was set aside. So this is probably a guess from other communities that have looked into it.
When you do, just out of curiosity, when you do that, aren't you pretty much sort of giving money? I mean, you're
yes.
You say, yeah. We now have $20,000. What's your bid?
Yeah, I mean, it depends how many people come back with bids.
I mean, do you get a bid of $15,000 if you allocate 20?
You can, yeah. I mean, for the Fountain Project, for example, we got bids significantly less than the amount of funding we disclosed we had available. People want to work sometimes. Sometimes not. Sometimes it's tough to get bidders on projects. It all depends.
Other questions for Jim? Thank you for pinch hitting here.
Would it be possible, one of the people who's here tonight, who was going to be a supporter, give some testimony, Maris Berkowitz from the Fair Housing Center in Holyoke, is here tonight but can't come on April 5th. Could she say a few words about our proposal? Because you just can't make that
sure.
Date.
Sure, yeah.
Thanks. Yep.
Thanks, Jim.
Well, thank you very much. As Jim mentioned, my name is Maris Berkowitz, and I am the Executive Director of Massachusetts Fair Housing Center. And I know you had some questions about the 2012 report, so I just want to let you know that our organization wrote that, did the research and the analysis and writing of that report. So if you have any further questions, hopefully I could answer some of them for you. But I guess what I'd really like to say this evening is I think this is a wonderful opportunity for Northampton to be a leader in evaluating, you know, in using this, these new tools and this opportunity to evaluate what are the impediments to fair housing in Northampton and how can Northampton overcome that, overcome them to become a truly inclusive community, because that's a process. And it's a process that has to be deliberately entered into in order to reverse some of the existing and very entrenched racial segregation in our area. So you can look at Northampton, I think, fairly as being part of the epicenter of an area that is ranked number one in the country for the rate of segregation between whites and Latinos. That's a fact. It's also in the top 20% in this MSA, which is comprised of Hamden and Hampshire County. It's in the top 20% for the rate of segregation between whites and Africans or African Americans. So, you know, it's really important that we address this as part of our mission, certainly, and we receive funding from HUD to affirmatively further fair housing. That's sort of the umbrella that this comes in under through the CDBG program. So it's really through the CDBG program that municipalities who receive these funds are required to take steps to affirmatively further fair housing. And the way that that has historically occurred is through this process that had been called an analysis of impediments to fair housing, but now is called the fair housing assessment process. So there was a change in policy under the Obama administration to put forward these goals and to make to actually step up enforcement against municipalities that were not, you know, doing their share of this work. I don't know if anybody has any questions at this point. I can keep sort of talking about why we think this is important. And I think your question about, or your comment about, you know, are we going to get a report that tells us we need more affordable housing? Well, yes, that would be a part of it, I think, because the 10% goal that is in the state law is good. I mean, it's a progressive law, but it really isn't adequate. I mean, the way they measure the 10% can be faulted as not being really even achieving 10% affordable housing in a jurisdiction. But there are other measures that don't even necessarily cost money that should be examined and I think should undergo some kind of expert and critically important public review. And I'm just going to just toss out a few ideas. Residency preferences, so that the Northampton Housing Authority, which is entry-level housing for low-income people, has a residency preference, which basically means that unless you live or work in Northampton, you will never, you're not likely to ever be able to access housing through the Northampton Housing Authority. We have a program that we've begun, which is to encourage housing mobility for recipients of Section 8 housing assistance. So that program would rely on maybe recruiting, our office is in Holyoke, recruiting landlords in Northampton who would be willing to work with us. You know, if we were to introduce candidates who were willing to use their Section 8, which is a voucher program that people theoretically, with their housing voucher, low-income families, many of whom work, theoretically should be able to obtain rental housing in a jurisdiction like Northampton. Now, the rents are very high, and that is a barrier in and of itself. But if we were able to recruit landlords to the wisdom of opening housing opportunities to people who have historically been locked out of communities like Northampton, we would be making, you know, really important strides in terms of furthering, you know, the racial integration in this area. We also, in the last year, filed a complaint with HUD against the Northampton Housing Authority because of their non-compliance with their requirement to provide language access, linguistic access to people who don't speak English. So we found some really glaring discriminatory practices by the Northampton Housing Authority. So these things are not that costly, but they really can be effective in promoting racial and economic integration.
Thank you.
Questions?
I think one of the things we're doing on the Housing Authority is using a lot of Section 8 vouchers to deal with the problem you earlier described. And I think as far as some of the language barriers, I think that's my experience is that that's recognized as an ongoing problem, was recognized as an ongoing problem, is still an ongoing problem, but we are relatively new into a new executive director there, and is a little bit different approach than what's been happened, but I certainly hear you.
Yeah, and the Section 8 program really was intended to enable people to move to communities of opportunity like Northampton, but you know, it has failed in many ways. So our pilot program of the Housing Mobility Support Program is to support people, and as I say, have a program of recruiting landlords to enable people to move to communities like Northampton with better schools. So you can imagine a family in Holyoke where the public schools are completely failed, and a family that would like to move. In fact, we had an intern from the Western New England School of Law last year who had been a beneficiary of moving from Holyoke to Meadowbrook, it was called at the time, and it completely changed his life. He went on to graduate from Northampton High School, went to Hampshire College, and graduated from law school last year. So you can vote for exclusion or you can vote for inclusion. I think Northampton is a welcoming community. We see this in the policy that welcomes refugees, which is so commendable and so appreciated. We think, as I said, this is a great opportunity to sort of show that you're aligned with the Obama housing policy rather than the Trump housing policy.
I think no one here is arguing for exclusion over inclusion specifically. And I guess what I'm struggling with is there seems to be a lot of knowledge about what the problems are in this room and elsewhere in the city and the overall community. I'm unclear, is it merely a matter of saying, I guess I'm unclear on what the tool specifically is doing.
The tool?
This new tool, what is it specifically doing to further, it seems like a lot of these things, we really know a lot about these things. So I'm not clear on what this $20,000 is doing.
Well, from my perspective, this goes on nationwide, these analyses, we'll call it the analysis, which has changed under the Obama administration.
So can you give a specific example of the kind of thing that would be done under this tool that was not done under the 2012 analysis?
I am not an expert on the tool. I'm an attorney. I'm really not a, like a graduate student I think that there are technological, I think there are databases, information databases at HUD that municipalities will have access to. I'm really sorry, I really can't speak to it. I have to say that I don't think that $20,000 for this project is at all unreasonable. And I could suggest other reports that you could look at. Boston has a great report. Of course, Boston, is a large city, and I'm not saying that's comparable, but it has a really wonderful analysis of impediments. Some of the ones in Chicago are really good. Newton, Massachusetts is maybe more comparable to Northampton. They have an analysis of impediments. It's not with a new tool. I do have an article, though, that talks about New Orleans having a new analysis, Philadelphia using these tools. These are, some of the large reports, but they are, they're encouraging the public participation, the focus groups, so you can really hear sort of from people on the ground what is going on you know, a cross-section of what is going on in terms of impediments to fair housing. And I know that there's a focus, a newly renewed focus, not just on what's happening within the borders of Northampton, but municipalities are directed to take a regional view, sort of really take into account what is happening within the region, which, as I mentioned, we live in the number one most segregated MSA, Metropolitan Statistical Area, in the nation for white Latino segregation. And that is nothing to be proud of. And it really is something, I think, to work toward eroding, you know, and breaking down whatever the structures are that has created that.
Would every municipality be responsible for doing this analysis on their own, or could it be done regionally?
It's recipients of HUD funding, so it's the CDBG.
So it could be a regional assessment done, and then each municipality within the region use that? For instance, could the Council of Governments do this?
I don't know the answer to that question. I know that Holyoke is part of a consortium, I think, of Chicopee and Westfield. Oh, do you know?
Yeah. I was going to say something else. But
I don't know. I don't know how that works. I can't really speak to that.
Is fair housing determined by race or by income?
It's fair. Well, there are protected categories under the law that created this duty for recipients of HUD funding to affirmatively further fair housing. Those protected categories are race, national origin, color, religion, sex.
Those are categories of protection that are widespread across a number of legal protections in our society. But I return my question, because there are times you've been talking to make your point, saying that talking about racial segregation, and my impression was that access to fair housing would be based on income issues. Is that correct?
I'm not sure.
Or is access to fair access to fair housing based on race? I'm certainly we don't want to discriminate.
I don't know what you mean by fair housing.
Well, the moderate low income housing that we've been supporting, is access to that based on race?
Is access to that based on race? No.
Okay.
No.
I hope not. I mean, I certainly would hope not.
I would call that affordable housing, though, not fair housing. Fair housing does implicate.
I'll take your term. Affordable housing is based on family or individual income, is it not?
Yes.
Okay.
Generally.
And so, I mean, I have to admit, I'm bothered by this seemingly open pathway between talking about. You know, to bolster your case about the appropriateness of it, the need for it, talking about racial issues, and when we have been supporting affordable housing based on individual income issues or financial background issues, which I hope is the foundation for access for all of the housing that Northampton is providing, and which I support.
It's more than affordable housing, though. It supports all housing.
It does cover all housing, but about affordable.
But we're, our nexus with this is affordable housing. We're not supporting all housing through this committee. So we're just supporting affordable housing, right? So I don't know why the racial issues exist, but as far as this committee is concerned and our support for affordable housing, should we be talking about race?
I think we should definitely be talking about race.
Okay.
Again, because we live in a highly an intensely segregated region of the country here in Western Massachusetts. So we're in the top 20% for racial segregation in housing. And the policy, just one of the policies that I mentioned to you for affordable housing in Northampton, I would say check if there are residential, if there are local residency preferences that attach to the affordable housing in Northampton. So in other words, these are preferences that there's always a waiting list for affordable housing because there's not enough of it probably anywhere in this country. So if that's being managed or governed by a residential preference, that is going to freeze the discrimination and the segregation that exists in the community. Or in the region, it's going to freeze that. It It's not going to change it. People are not going to be moved, because people who don't already live in Northampton or work in Northampton are not going to be able to get in. So I think those residency preferences have to be looked at very closely for having a racially discriminatory effect.
You're talking about the secondary impact of the way in which the community rents out its low-income housing. I mean, primarily the primary impact is to deal with the low-income housing, but because of the way we are segregated, the secondary impact is that we're perpetuating that segregation. I think that's the issue that's being looked at.
There's HUD money that's supporting affordable housing, and that money will be put at risk if we don't do it, if this analysis is not done, which, and the analysis covers racial as well as many other issues. So I think the connection to affordable housing is pretty clear.
I'm not trying to I voted for every affordable housing project that's come through here, and we'll look forward to continue to doing that. This is the first time, though, what I'm hearing is that we should use the affordable housing money to rectify racial discrimination or racial segregation patterns that currently exist, which would mean, in practice, what I'm hearing is that preferences would be given to certain racial groups in order to bring. No? That's
not. No, it would just be a removal of the local residency preference, just removing that.
But for the purpose of doing that you explained was
to open it up to people who don't live in Northampton.
To be clear, though, this
that's one of the recommendations that could come from
this
sort of a report that would go into depth. And I clearly hear that you're looking for additional information. What additional kind of value information would this $20,000 and this sort of thing, and that's something I'm going to talk to Peg Keller about. Yeah. Hopefully she's going
to. Just to clear.
She's not too sick, and I think you're looking for more specifics, and you deserve that, and I will talk with her tomorrow about getting that to you.
Just to clarify, this might not want to speak for anyone else. My concern about this, clearly $20,000 is not a lot of money in the big scheme of things. My worry is that there's many people who would love to be living under an Obama administration right now. The reality is the reality. And say we do this great report, and then 6 months down the line, there's something else that costs another $20,000 that's what the current HUD administration requires to get any money. I just want to make sure that kind of due diligence is done, because it's a slippery eel here.
Well, I mean, I think doing the report, doing the analysis of the barriers to fair housing in Northampton is just morally important in and of itself. If you care about some of these issues of racial disparities and racial justice and access to opportunity for people who've historically been locked out, I think it's just an important, you know, again, taking a stand on one side or the other. But we live in a very uncertain time, and have to make choices, difficult choices.
And it's a part of. We recently submitted an editorial, which maybe most of you have saw on the Gazette, trying to highlight and educate the community. So this is another thing where updated statistics, I think it was a month ago, there was an editorial that we wrote up. And so it's another part of it, just educating the community about where we're at in terms of the issues that Maris has raised. And so it's a community education thing. It's gonna help us plan workshops, is going to help us make recommendations, as Maris is suggesting, to the Northampton Housing Authority. So it's that sort of detailed stuff that'll have real concrete and updated data that hopefully will then give more credence to these recommendations that might come out of it. But I hear that you're looking for more detail on that, and I think Peg can provide that, and I'll get that to her tomorrow.
I did bring along a map. I don't know if I can distribute it.
Sure.
It was a bit of a revelation for me when I saw it. So it just shows the concentration, basically, by minority status for low income and Section 8 voucher holders.
Great, thank you. Any other questions? Thank you both for being here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, so last but not least is the Hampshire Inn expansion project. And as you know, a number of folks from the committee who was able to go to the site visit. Thank you, committee members, for doing that. All right, thank you.
Thank you for having me. This is my first time before this group. Would you like me to present or respond to questions?
Perhaps a brief presentation would be helpful, knowing that a bunch of folks were at the site earlier, so there may be some repetition for those of us who were not there.
Okay.
But a brief presentation and then open for questions. Okay.
So Valley CDC purchased this particular...
I'm sorry, and your name
I'm
is?
Sorry. I'm Laura Baker. I'm the real estate project manager for Valley CDC. Valley CDC purchased this property at 82 Bridge Street in 1990. It's been operated as a single-room occupancy building since that time. It's a traditional SRO, meaning that people basically rent a bedroom. There's one common kitchen, and in this building there are four shared bathrooms. Prior to 1990, it was operated as Jesse's House homeless shelter. Before that, it was a lodging house, and before that, we believe it was a single-family home. It's an old building built in 1820. It's a contributing structure in the historic district. The building as it stands needs some significant capital repairs, given its age and the level of use that it's had over the years. So what we're proposing is to try to restore the original main building, especially the front facade of the building, and address some safety and capital needs within the building. We'd like to add an elevator to the building, because currently there is no handicapped access on any of the floors, and put an addition on the property. It's about a half acre property, kind of a narrow, deep lot, so we have space to put an addition. And so it would convert from a 15-room traditional SRO to a 31-unit enhanced SRO. Enhanced SRO simply means that they're tiny efficiencies. So instead of having shared kitchen and shared baths, each room would have a three-quarter bathroom and a kitchenette. The rooms would still be very small. We would hope to carry forward eight Section 8s that we have in place in the property and augment them, hopefully, with some other rental subsidies. And then the balance of the units would still be income restricted, but the rents wouldn't be as low as they could be in the units that had rental subsidies. So I think that's the basic premise. I do have plans here if people want to see visuals of kind of the site or plans of what the property might look like after it's been developed.
Sure. Maybe just pulling up a few of you.
So, this is the existing site. This is Bridge Street here. There's one building here, and then there's historic Northampton here. So, we're right across from where the former Shaw's Hotel used to be. It's now recently been demolished. Bridge Street School is one of our abutters. We met with the principal at Bridge Street School this week, and as we suspected, they have not had any issues with our presence next to the school over all the years that we've been there. Proposed plan, again, Bridge Street is here, so retaining the original house structure, kind of widening out the back house portion of it. There's a garage here that would be demolished. We have an elevator here that you entered on grade and could access all three floors of the building, and then the new addition back here, so you could go up and access all three floors, either in the old house or the new addition. I'm showing a deck here. The parking currently runs about to here, 7 or 8 spaces of diagonal parking, proposing extending it and having 15 spaces of parking. There's a very large backyard now, and Now it will be a medium-sized backyard, consume part of it, just bike racks.
May I ask a question?
Yes.
So, in reading the proposal, it says the, in terms of zoning approval.
Yes.
The project does not comply at this point with the density limits, and you haven't gone through that process to get through zoning to get a, whatever the term is.
The zoning process is midway, so just earlier, was it Monday? There was a hearing in this room. The legislative committee of the city council and the planning board met, held a joint public hearing. So the city is intending, and we think they'll be successful, in putting an overlay, basically a smart growth district, on this one parcel, similar to the district that's at Village Hill. So it's a zoning mechanism that's, they need to approve it at the state level, they need to vote it in at the local level, at the city council level. It allows you to create increased density when you're developing affordable housing. And for every unit that you increase that's affordable, the city gets compensated a little bit of money from the state.
Maybe.
If they have the money. In the past, that's been possible. So we're midway. The state has the document. Again, it's been through the public hearing process, and it'll go to city council for vote.
She hopes the first part of April.
First part of April, hopefully. If that fails, which I don't think it will, the other zoning path is using what's called a comprehensive permit, which is specifically when you're developing affordable housing. It allows you to request waivers from zoning, local zoning requirements, and it's specific to affordable housing development. We certainly could go that path. It's a little bit, in terms of time, it takes a little bit longer because we need to go to the state first. They do a bunch of site visits and things, and then we come to the ZBA and they hold hearings on it.
Thank you.
Sure. Let's see. We actually have two potential looks to this building. I like showing them to people to see what they like. In both of these different looks, I'm going to show you the floor plan remains the same. So this was our initial cut at this. This is the front of the building. And this is...
Laura, could you take one step back? So.
Yeah.
Can you stick it up on the... I don't know whether... Right there in the dais? I mean, does... Can you hold it up there?
I can. Or I can walk around with it. It's hard to see. You guys are kind of far away. At any rate, one potential look for this building is to do kind of mimic the gable roof here. Because we want three stories, it starts to get really high, so the architect gave us some dormers. So that's one potential. And then we have another version. Again, same footprint, same interior design. And this is just a flat roof version. We're kind of leaning toward this because it's shorter and more compact. A little bit less expensive to build a roof, a little bit better for solar panels. But we're in conversation with Historic Northampton because they're a near neighbor. We will be in conversation with the Northampton Historical Commission, and that could sway our decision making about the look of it. And a couple of renderings. Okay. This is, you know, basically a rendering based on a photograph. This is what this building might look like. If you're kind of standing in front, looking at both the front and along the side by the driveway with that gable version that we talked about. And then if you're standing in the kind of courtyard area of Historic Northampton, looking over at it, which is what Historic Northampton is thinking about, that's what you would see. And we went with this version. Basically same angles of view. If you're standing in front, seeing the front and the side of the building, and if you're standing behind Historic Northampton, looking over through the abutting properties.
I'm ready to vote.
Go, Linda.
I'll take A, please.
People's choice.
I'm sorry, which one is that?
The Gables.
The Gables.
Yeah, yeah.
Keeping the Gables, not the...
The more traditional look.
Yeah.
Why do the Gables, why is it harder to do a solar installation on the gable?
It's just a little more limited because they may be pointing...
They'd be facing the wrong way.
The wrong way.
They may, right.
And definitely half of it's gonna be facing the solar.
Yeah, the flat, well...
Yeah, flat refuge, you just cover it with panels.
This was maybe by Bruce Kibiski, who's on the architect, who's on the central business architectural committee, is that when you're adding on to an historically significant structure, intent, even under federal guidelines, is not to try to mimic or to recreate the image that this was in fact also an old part of the building, but to actually make it quite clear that this is a definite different structure.
And it speaks of its age, of its time, that's contemporary, but it's not to everyone's liking. It may be a little bit of an acquired taste. You know, the architects show us lots
of
historic buildings with these new modern things. They love them, but you know, we're going to be responsive to our neighbors and to our local historic commission.
You'll see the building that used to belong to Clark, that's going to have the business software company. You're going to see a very lovely addition on the back of that that has that honors the original architecture, but it's clearly a newer addition. It's handled really well.
I guess the question is if you want to vote with your dollars.
Did I miss that you were putting panels on this, or is this a thought for a later time?
It's really a thought for a later time, although we're always looking to at least set up the building with the infrastructure
that can be
adapted. Okay,
but I just didn't think that was part of it. That's why I wanted to.
So your timeline says that on March 15th, 2017, you'll have a cost estimate. Today happens to be March 15th, 2017. Is there a cost estimate, or...?
There is not.
There is not, okay.
I mean, there is an estimate that's included in the budget that's based on square foot prices.
Right, yeah.
We have not advanced from that. We got a little stuck in this internal discussion about roof lines, and we'd like to resolve that before we put it out to a cost estimator.
Okay, because some seem very optimistic, the numbers that are in there right now. And especially after looking at it today, there's a lot of places to spend money in that building. There's not a lot in the report, as you well know, that says, oh, it's all great, you know, leave it as it is. It's basically everything needs to be addressed.
Yeah, we had a MEP engineer, mechanical, electrical, and plumbing come through, and so, you know, we're trying to sort what kind of HVAC system will go in there, and that's going to greatly affect cost as well. So once we figure that out and land on one of these, we'll do a third-party cost estimate.
So I guess that said, I might be off by a factor of two or something. Who knows? Would that put you in a position where you'd have to come back to CPA for additional funding? This was a...
You know, these budgets, people, they evolve significantly as we work our way through the project. Some of the sources that are named in here are dependent on the total cost of the project, for better or worse. So the largest source in here is the low-income housing tax credit, which if your construction costs go up, your amount that you're eligible for can also go up. Would it solve the problem entirely if the construction cost is higher? I don't know the answer. I feel like this is a pretty high ask from the CPA committee, partly because we're looking at historic as well as community housing. It's kind of both hitting on a couple of different fronts. But if you give us $500,000, we will not come back and ask for more. That's a lot of money.
So it's really about who you're asking from.
Who you're asking from, and you know, how can you contain the cost of the project?
Among the requirements from any of these people, is there a specific amount of local money that has to be?
No.
Okay, so we're not dealing with some hard and fast notion that there has to be a certain percentage.
No. the more the better, but there isn't. It's really a testament to the community's support for the project. Mm-hmm. And it's looked at a little differently than if you just wrote a support letter. They like to see, for example, the fact that the city's willing to do this special zoning is a huge testament to support. The city puts in some money, that's a testament as well. I think they're looking for the amount that goes in to be somewhat related to the size of the community. So tiny towns, we put a tiny amount in. Boston, Cambridge, Somerville, they'd be probably looking, expecting something more significant.
Okay. So the committee simply doesn't have this amount of money at this point? So even if it was a unanimous vote and everybody loved it, we couldn't come up with it even if we were to bond. If a smaller amount was provided now, do you think that would be sufficient for your funding sources to at least consider the applications at this point?
It's meaningful, any amount is meaningful at the point when we apply to the state. You know, if it's not the $500,000 that's showing in our budget, we need to rework that budget and find other sources, because ultimately we do need to kind of get this budget to balance. You know, my hope is if the committee really liked the project and wanted to support it, that we could get kind of a placeholder small amount from this fiscal year and kind of without prejudice be able to come back potentially next year and see if more funds were available.
We have what available, about 90,000 total?
Mm-hmm.
And you heard the other application, so placeholder would be, you know, really small.
When are you going to the state?
You know, the earliest would be probably this time of year, a year from now.
Okay.
How much of a hardship would it be to delay really any serious contemplation until the fall, given the fact that we have under $100,000 to work with at this point?
Not that serious. You know, I'm interested in what the committee thinks about the merits of the project. Because that's meaningful to know that, as we set our own internal expectations. But yeah, I don't think there's a make or break issue with us, whether it's from this round or the fall round. And partly we wanted to come in and make you aware that this is on the horizon, we're starting to work on it, we're working on zoning, and just so that it's on people's radar screen that we're gonna be working on it.
Just to make that even more excruciating for you, if it were actually broken into, $500,000 is a lot,
mm-hmm.
And it's not impossible, but it would be hard for the committee perhaps to commit that much all in one round. We have no idea what else is going to come in, but that would preclude really anything else of much significance. So I know nothing about the availability of CDBG money. I think you have $100,000 in here. Is there any possibility of that increasing? It's the first question, and the second is, how much would it mess you up if we were to fund this in stages? So you would not have it in hand at all that you needed and wanted in hand at the time that you submitted your application, but I'm thinking you wouldn't get funded that round anyway.
Any way that you have money will work with you. I mean, we would appreciate any money at any time. I mean, it's the reality of it.
I mean, so, it does help that you own it, but I don't know
yes.
if there's anything really critical in the building. The structural report makes me a little queasy, but I can't evaluate that. I don't know. So I just don't know what your sense of urgency is. Sooner rather than later, I'm sure, but is there something that's really impelling you that says it's got to get done?
No, it's just long overdue,
mm-hmm.
that's all.
Yeah, that much
is
clear.
And it doesn't all have to be in hand.
No, in fact, when we go into the state, you know, money that's committed is committed. So you have to have it in order to commit to us. We can be working off budgets that have kind of, you know, as we do,
prospective amounts. When we go into the state, we would only show a budget that had committed amounts, unless you were able to say something, which I don't think you can say, like, we'd love to give you some more money next year, because you can't forward commit. I don't think the committee's in a position to do that. You could say it to me verbally, but I don't think you could put it in writing.
I think we could probably say, and Sarah told me otherwise, that we would seriously entertain, but we have to see, out of fairness to the other applicants, we have to see what the other applications are. So we could indicate an interest, but we couldn't.
Right.
Go beyond that.
Is there a fallback of not doing an addition and just renovating the existing building?
That's what I wanted to ask.
You know, what has happened with this building in the past is kind of spot repairs, like the roof was done, the boiler was done, and that's probably the fallback. I think the chances that we could raise the money the building really needs to renovate it are unlikely. So when the state, which they have got the big money, you know, they publish their priorities, so they have a strong priority for new units over preserved units, very strong priority. Mm-hmm. So if we have 15 units and we get to 31, more than 50% of our units are new, we're falling into that creating new units category, and we're not in the preservation category anymore. If we're preserving, I don't think we would be competitive at the state level. Now, could we raise some local money and do something to improve the building? Yes, we probably could. But the level of need in this building is, as I was saying to someone who stayed after, it's like, we can't really start pulling it apart without having the money to really fix it, because it does have significant capital and structural needs. And certainly something like an elevator wouldn't happen.
I was going to say accesses.
Right. So we could do, you know, but we, sure, could we do a ramp to get some people to the first floor? Sure. You know, that's, again, there's always a way. But certainly the vertical access, which is preferred, you wouldn't do it for 15 units, probably. You need to kind of scale up. But the same token, having on-site property management or having on-site service providers, you don't really get those things until you kind of ramp up the project.
The city publishes annual surveys of statistics about the value of the average residential unit, whether it's a house or a condo or apartment in the city. And what people talk to me about is the difference between the average residential unit in the city as a gross number, not just as a square foot number, but as a gross number, compared to the cost of some of the units that are being constructed these days in the city center in order to respond to housing issues and needs. Mm-hmm. And my concern is that there should be an indexing, should be a sensitivity. Every dollar we hand out is coming on top of all the tax money that people pay who have homes here in the city. And it's hard won, and we need to be very careful about how it's spent. So if the cost of the of an enhanced SRO is far greater per room, per living unit, than the cost of an average home in the city, as has been sometimes the case with some of these projects, people do wonder. And that I recognize that the city, through our agency, is contributing a small minority of the total project cost. I get that. But at the same time, it does threaten even the support for this small portion of the project cost because of that discrepancy. Now, I've asked that question several times, and people assure me that it all goes to good places and under good stewardship and this and that, but I still don't understand it, because whether you look at the square footage, you know, cost per square foot, or whether you look at the total cost per living unit, these projects are wicked expensive.
Yeah, I agree.
And frankly, they're going to lose support in the city unless the agencies that are doing this index keep a close eye on what the rest of the city is living in and the values that
these units are about $220,000 a unit.
I can't hear you.
These units are about coming in about $220,000 a unit. So they're less than the average house value in Northampton.
Yeah.
Now they're tiny.
But
if you compare it with new construction, like if you look at Village Hill, for example, where condos that are, you know, are coming in at almost $500,000 for new construction. So it's not a terrible, terrible number. It's not a great number. What I would say to folks, I have a couple of responses to folks. You know, this is a specialized type of housing. We're putting more bathrooms and kitchens per square foot than anyone ever would anywhere. So we'd expect a higher square foot price. We're trying to get access. We're trying to put in an elevator. That's expensive. We're trying to restore an old historic building, which people would spend a lot of money on and not produce any new housing at all, period. No new housing, just for the restoration. We're going to have a 99-year deed restriction on this property. So what you're buying, one hopes, with the initial capital outlay is many, many, many generations of housing for low-income folks. So it's a long, I mean, if you think about what you pay for a new school in Northampton, and the square foot costs there are going to be, I don't know, 3-4 times the square foot costs in something like this.
Let's not put too much stock into that. The square foot cost is not based on anything at this point. So.
And, you know, think about how often we're replacing schools or libraries or other things that we expect to be there for the public good for a very long period of time. So I think it's significant to think about the longevity of what we're trying to accomplish before expecting us to own, maintain, continue to have low rents for 99 years. So it not only has to be really good quality construction, it has to be set up with an operating budget that we're somehow able to kind of continue to save enough money to do capital repairs over 99 years. That's a pretty tall order.
Is there an existing deed restriction?
There is an existing deed restriction. It is from CDAC. They were a lender in the year 2000, so it's called HIF money. So they have a 99-year deed restriction in place.
Is there a number in your budgeting that would make this project infeasible in terms of construction costs? Or is it, no matter what this cost, is there an upper limit to what makes this worth doing?
You mean when it gets just too expensive
yeah.
and we have to walk away from it?
Yeah.
I don't know the answer to that.
How would you come up with an answer for that?
I think at some point, if your per unit cost is so high that the state won't look at your project, mm-hmm. you have a pretty significant problem. So they're looking at per unit total development costs, the 220 I mentioned, of, you know, in Boston area, over $400,000.
Oh, yeah.
Out here, well into the 300s.
Sure.
But at some point, that number just gets too big for everybody to kind of say this is not a good use of public resources. We're pretty far away from that number right now.
So you think the 300s is that number? Is that fair?
Yeah, I think for SRO housing, if we get up, if our number starts with a 3, that's not a good place to be in.
Well, because you said here 220 now,
mm-hmm.
right? So.
So can I just,
yeah.
I hate to do it, but I'm going to throw something
yeah.
back at you.
Yeah.
So Valley CC is doing this project down at the lumberyard site, and
yeah.
We just did some estimating with actual general contractors. We did a preliminary bid on that. We came in at 153 a square foot.
New construction,
right. Elevator, all the site work, brick face
right.
on two sides of the building. So in terms of square foot, you know, again, it's until you really get out there, you don't know. I think these are reasonable numbers given our other recent bidding experience. So, I mean, I hear you.
I hope you're right.
And some of it's how you design the HVAC and you know,
are you thinking about a centralized system?
We're thinking of reusing
split?
The boiler that's in the building.
Yeah.
Because it's oversized.
Just for the sake of, again, because we represent the public in Northampton, you're quite right. There are luxury apartments going up in Northampton that are extremely expensive. And as you also know, there are modest little capes towards the periphery of the city that could easily go for 220, and the owners would be very happy that you get that much. And so that's kind of what we, and those are the people often, whoever.
I dare you to find a little cape in downtown for 220.
Oh, no one was saying downtown, but as a community,
yeah.
Everyone's paying taxes, not just people downtown. So when an SRO is costing the same as a whole house with a yard in Ryan Road, that's when people begin to ask, I'm obviously going to support this, it's great, but I think the agencies need to keep a finger on the pulse of the communities and not have through design or whatever, or with their administrative costs, not have units that are so expensive that they are straining the credibility of people who are paying for these.
Yeah.
I think that, and I hear what you're saying too, I think that one of the things that struck me, because I hadn't really thought about it, but when we did the visit, is that there was parking, and you said for roughly 25% of the occupancy, and that seemed to be. And one of the things that has always been true is that, you know, one of the things that you buy when you move into a particular area is access to services. And if you're trying to serve a community that is relying on mass transit, then that's automatically going to do something to the cost, because you're not going to put it out at the end of the line. You want to put it somewhere where it actually makes a difference. So I think that that's one of the things where I don't know that necessarily answers your question, but when I was, you know, when I was living in an urban setting, I had to factor into my rent an extra $500 to be within walking distance of Metro. And my attitude to that was, well, I'll take the cut and put the $500 in my car. But that's not a viable option for some people. And so I think that, you know, access to mass transit is just it's the obvious one to me, but it's one of the services. Walking distance to the downtown area is something that I think is an important reason for locating a house that services low income people in that kind of neighborhood, and that's got a cost associated with it. So I think that's a pretty compelling argument. I'd certainly be comfortable making it.
Other questions? Is there a way to separate out costs for historic preservation and community housing on this? I mean, I haven't seen anything that says this much would be for actually historic preservation. But you may or may not know, we are mandated to allocate a certain amount of money for historic preservation.
Yeah.
And so if there would be a way that we could play with these figures, so some could come out of historic preservation perhaps, and some out of our affordable housing mandate, that might be helpful for us.
Yeah, that was my assumption when I put this high number out to you folks, was that you would have the ability to tap both of those.
To play with that, okay. Because I'm assuming the historic preservation will be a huge amount, and most of it is obviously affordable housing.
Yeah.
Okay. The other question I had was, you had a sort of a long list of where the sources of funds are. Have any of those come through? Like the Smith College, you have $100,000.
No.
Nothing has come in yet.
No.
So we're essentially the first to ask, is that correct?
Yeah, which is typical. It's usually CPA and CDBG that we look to first as the local portion. And then the state money, even though there's lots of different funds listed, it typically is one kind of massive application that we do all at once. Smith College is a little, you know, they did contribute some recently, actually, for the Lumberyard project. They used to put in a lot more, so it's kind of a dwindling resource, but, you know, I think we would advance this project a bit more, probably, before asking for their money.
So if you came back in the next round, I guess you would come with an SD or DD cost estimate along with it. on that. I hate to sound like we're drilling down on this. Mm-hmm. Just, I think David's point is, you know, I think we're in a situation where with big municipalities joining the CPA, mm-hmm. we're gonna see a lot less state match of the dollars that yep. Northampton's putting in.
Yep.
So people may not have such positive feelings about putting their money into this pool if they're not getting the state backup, if they don't feel that the projects are managed. Not that I'm not accusing,
I
think just really important to the long-term viability of the CPA as a whole. Mm-hmm.
Other questions?
Yes.
Comments? Thank you so much for taking your time, and good luck with all of your projects.
Yeah. And so next steps for us, do we talk with Sarah? Is that what we do next?
We will hear on our next meeting, folks getting public comment on proposals. So you're welcome and encouraged to ask people to attend our next meeting to speak.
Okay.
If they choose, obviously, in support or in opposition to the project.
Okay.
So, so we go to this sort of public meeting, our next time, right?
Yeah.
Which is April.
Yeah. So 3 weeks from today.
3 weeks from
today. Okay, great. Thank you.
Here at 7 o'clock.
Thanks for coming to see the property, too, those of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
All right. We are done with our three.
There's one more.
One more. Right. We have Lathrop coming on April 5th.
Yeah, so Lathrop got bounced from the small grants round to the full grants round, so they will be here April 5th. There was no one associated with the project. It was not who was in town today.
and we're walking out there today anyway.
No, so, and we'll also do the site visit next time because there will not be snow 3 weeks from today. Absolutely.
Are you sure?
I am sure.
The next item on the agenda is other business not foreseen when the agenda was published. Is there anything that we need to be bringing up? If not, is there a motion to adjourn? A second. We'll see you on the